Logistically, this has been a very, very large season. We've seen three ships operate, three new ships for the first time in Antarctica, and it's not just the conduct of those voyages, but it's preparing them to operate in Antarctica.
We were actually testing our bathymetry systems, and that's actually sending echo sounds down into the ocean to map the sea floor. And there we actually found a deep sea canyon that comes right off the front of the glacier, going down to about 2,200 metres. And that was previously unknown. We had no idea that the depth actually extended to that level. We were also able to use our moon pool to put down what we call CTD equipment, which can actually sample the water at the bottom of that canyon to be able to determine whether or not things like the water chemistry and the water temperature were changing, so that we could look at whether or not that actually plays a role in glacial melt. So very early days, but some really exciting early discoveries. We have a wet well on Noyina, and this is one of the real game-changing things that the Noyina brings to our science, because it allows us to be able to capture really delicate marine life in almost pristine condition. So we put that through its paces on this first voyage, and in fact we, within moments of commissioning the equipment, we were able to capture live krill in almost perfect condition. And in fact we brought back 15,000 live krill to the aquaria here in Hobart that the researchers can continue to work on over the next 12 months.
We've had a huge resupply at Casey this year. Not only all of the routine resupply and refueling, but effectively we've just delivered another station to Antarctica. So both the traverse equipment and a new summer inland station to support the search for a million-year-old ice core is an enormous undertaking. You know, 1,000 tonnes of cargo, huge volumes, and logistically challenging to unload large pieces of equipment onto barges, ship those to shore, and then move them through the station, through a bottleneck to get them up onto the plateau, and then get them ready for next year's traverse. So it's a massive undertaking.
This year is the first year where we're getting really stuck into the Macquarie Island modernisation project. So unlike the continental stations, the infrastructure on Macquarie Island is really quite sparse and quite rustic, for want of a better word. And it's been in a really harsh environment for a long time. So a lot of those buildings and infrastructure are really in need of improvement. So our year we'll have a bigger than usual contingent of trades people. So there's 21 people total for our year, and a large contingent of those are tradesfolk. And their job will be getting stuck into those big improvement projects. So previous years have done some groundwork for us, which has been great. But this year's the first year we really get stuck into about a 6 or 8 year project of improving the infrastructure.
We've had a fair bit of catching up to do. COVID has really constrained the program over the last couple of years, but this season the scale of our operations has really made a dent in catching up. Mawson's always a challenge to resupply. It's the end of the line, it's our most distant station, and quite often the ice conditions around the station are incredibly challenging. We saw that play out last year where we had to conduct a helicopter resupply of the station for emergency supplies. We were unable to refuel the station. So over the winter period, we airdropped cargo in by C-17 that was air-to-air refueled to get down there. That kept the station operating until the summer months, and this year we're able to send down two ships to both refuel the station and get in a normal resupply. It's the first time in 2 years, and it really sets us up for the years ahead.
I I was very lucky to be able to participate with one of the ice core drilling projects. And this is also a long-term monitoring project that we run out here at the Antarctic Division. And every couple of years we go back and we take about another 15 metres of ice core to give us overlap to the previous 15 metres of ice core that we've taken a few years earlier. And this actually gives us really high resolution data about things like precipitation, how much snow is falling. Some of the chemicals that are actually included in the snow tell us things like how much algae is present on the sea ice because it gets transported in winds. So we get a lot of high resolution information out of having these long-term ice core records.
It's pretty exciting being part of a program that has a clear focus, and we've got the tools and products to deliver the support we need to in Antarctica.